Hello, this is Christy. In today's video, I'm going to have a first look at a video editor software called Shotcut. This is a free open source cross-platform video editor. It runs on Linux, Windows, Mac, and I can't believe I didn't know about it until now. And I was looking for a way to play a video in reverse, and I found this on Google. I thought, hey, this is probably free. This is probably not very good. But from the screenshots and the reviews and the feature list on their website, shotcut.org, it seems like a very capable piece of software. So on my channel, I've been covering Premiere Pro, which is not free. I've been covering Camtasia videos and other video editing stuff. And I haven't covered much free software. So in this video, I haven't actually installed this yet. So I'm installing it right now for the first time. I'm downloading it. If you go to the download page here, you can download it and install it. And let's see what it can do. Okay, so I've downloaded the software. Now I'm going to install it. As we can see, the GNU General Public License here. So it is free, it is open source. I'm gonna just install with the basics, the defaults, and let's see how fast it works. Apparently the underlying rendering and conversion and editing engine is FFmpeg, which is also free. And if you look here in the feature list, I mean, it's quite impressive. It seems to support 4K, ProRes, all these formats and 4K resolutions, and you know, a bunch of audio filters and effects and mixing and all that stuff, and then video effects and editing features. So you know, I mentioned before it works on these platforms, so let's have a look. So now I've finished installing it. Let's close this and let's run it. Okay, so the program has launched. Now let me resize this window a little bit to fit my screen here. Okay, so it seems that I can do a new project here in the project folder, a project name. I'm just not gonna bother moving stuff, so I'm just gonna call it First Look Video. And video mode, so the resolution and frame rate based on the first file you add. That is fine by me. And let's say if we wanted to edit video for YouTube, maybe we could probably do an HD 1080p at 2997 or 25 frames per second. Let's try 25. So if I specify this here, apparently it's going to keep it at that resolution no matter what video clips I'm adding. So let's click start. Okay, so there is nothing here. Very specific. Let's see. So the interface seemed to be, of course, like most other editors, it's kind of dark gray. So we have a toolbar at the top here. It's a peak meter. Okay, we can turn it on and off. Properties on and off. So these panels appear here. Recent playlist timeline. The timeline is down here. Okay, so let's find a video clip and import this clip onto the project. So let me see if I can drag this, what happens to it? Okay, so it starts playing, but also I'm seeing the properties for my clip here, driving and recent files used in this right side panel here. And we can see the controls at the bottom here, similar to the other software like Premiere and Camtasia. So you can have the play buttons here. You can start and stop the playback, and you can have zooming, or you can zoom fit, and you can have a grid. That's fine. That's great. So that's the source, and this is the, there's two tabs here. They seem to be the source and the project. Now I'm just getting familiarized with this. I haven't used it before. So let's see, view, layout, let's say timeline project, clip only project, playlist project, player. Okay, let's try timeline project. So this is the layout you can use. Now, if you use the plus here, you can add filters to this video file, but I'm curious how to add this to the timeline. Okay, so this plus sign here allows you to add the append, or you know, add the clip to the track, to the timeline, and then you can shift it like this with this hand selection tool. So now I am actually on the timeline editing. I'm not sure if this can be resized. Yes, you can pull this up. Okay, so there you go. So this is how you modify your layout. You have these little dots on the sides, so you can change the layout and the size of the different elements like this. And if you need to do multi-tracks, you have very, very similar to Premiere and all the other software. You have V1, such as Video 1, which has audio and video in a single track, which is a bit different then. You can split them. If you right-click on this, you can cut, copy, remove, lift, and so on. Detach audio, which will separate the audio and the video. Yes, as I assumed. So if I want my video to not have audio, I can probably just delete this audio track. There we go. So now the video is playing with no sound. That is fine. So you have the timeline here. If I drag another video in here, let's see. Okay, this is the same video, but it's a different color on it. So if I want to go now and add this here, I can add a video track, right clicking on the timeline, and now I want to add this clip. Driving unprocessed, I can drag it down here or not. This track, no, I can't. Maybe clicking the plus sign, yes. So apparently you can't really drag stuff around. Maybe I'm missing something here, but you cannot drag stuff in here, so you have to use this plus button to append to the current track. And then you have all these controls here to do with the track. So like, for example, here you can zoom in and out to see more or less. And then you can detach audio like this. So you can delete the audio if you want. So now I have two clips on the timeline. They are in sync. So if I move one of them, then this one is playing and then this other one shows up. So this is the same principle. The video tracks that are above appear above, of course, above the stack. So they would be in front of the camera. So it's the same like in Premiere Pro. Okay. Now, let's see what happens if I just zoom out here and try and put these clips. Okay, you can drag them on the timeline apparently, and they will snap. It seems they do snap. Okay, now let's see if I import an audio file. Can I actually put an audio file as the background sound for this video? So I'm gonna go and find an audio file. Okay, this is quite annoying. When you drag a new file in there, it starts playing automatically, so I guess that could be maybe one of the settings you can probably turn off somewhere. And now let's see, if I just put the playhead somewhere random like this and I go to the audio track, I can only remove it from here, there's nothing to do. So if I drag this down here, it doesn't seem to put it on the timeline, which is quite annoying this. So apparently I have to select the track, audio track in this case, and just select the file I want to add and click plus, which then puts it in the file in the timeline, and I can then drag this around and change it. So now let's see, is it playing with sound? Yes, so that's good. Okay, this is basic editing. I'm not trying to do anything advanced in here. I'm just trying to explore the interface of this software. So I have the audio track on a separate track here. I have the couple of video things. So let's see how we can add some titles, if we can. Okay, so the filters, apparently if you want to add some text, you need to use filters, which sounds a little unintuitive for me because, you know, text is not really filters. It's more like an asset or a title. So you need to go to filters here, and then you click this plus sign, and then you have a lot of stuff in here you can add. And you can have favorites, video, and audio. So if you go to video, then you see all of these things, they apparently are filters. So there's old film noise, all of these things, which, yeah, they do make sense to be called filters. But then there is a text element filter here. So there's two, there's a 3D one and an HTML one, which apparently they are deprecated. And now there is text simple. Now, if I click on this, you can see here, I can actually have text time code. You can resize this. It seems to create like a frame with the element. I can resize and move from the center dot here. And let's try and put some text in here. So welcome to Shotcut. Okay, this is my text. Yeah, I added the filter to the audio file by mistakes. Okay, beginner mistake. Apparently these filters, they can be added to a specific element. So I'm gonna actually go to the track here, click on the track. There's nothing on this video track here. And see, look, it's showing me the title. So these are the filters for this track. Now let's try again. Let's add this next one. You can search here for filters, text simple. Here it is. And let's say, welcome to Shotcut again. So this is my text. Apparently you can change the preset for this element to be like a lower third or slow move down, like a bit of an animation top left, and it will move it automatically top right. This is the position of the element, and obviously if I drag this and resize it, the position changes, the size changes. So I'm going to put it in the middle here like that. So I've obviously added this to the video track, but the track doesn't have anything. So I'm curious, if I move one of these clips in here and now click the track, I see the text on there. So the text now appears on top of the track. It's probably because the track was blank. The name filter for the text is appropriate in that sense, because it seems that even if you add a filter with text on it, it doesn't appear until there's actual video in there, so that the filter or text can be superimposed. So yes, this is what it happens. So now I can actually see my text. I don't seem to be able to control the alignment here, so I'm not sure. This is top right. I suppose it respects maybe this. Let's try bottom left. Yes, that's where the whole thing goes. So if I make the container larger, it enlarges the text as well. Let's see, can we add new lines? Yes, we can. Okay, and if I want to select a single word and make it a different color, that doesn't work. So it makes the whole text that color. That's okay, I guess. Limited editing facility there for the titles. You can move it from here. And now, let's see, can I align this? Default, okay. Default seems to be centered. So I guess if you play with the size a bit, you can center your title like this. Quite a cumbersome way to work with this. If I want to change the color, it changes the whole thing. So yeah. That's not, I'm not really impressed with this. But anyway, I guess for a free tool to add quick titles and annotations on your text, on your video, that is fine. Okay, let's move on. So I have now video. I have two video tracks here. There's one on top of the other. So, and then there's an audio file playing there. So, okay. I guess that's enough for now. I'm gonna try to export this video file now. See how that comes out, what happens with that. So to export, let's try to go to file maybe. You have export video, export an individual frame apparently, EDL. This is like a file to dictate the segments, I believe. So export video, let's see. So we have all these presets now. So the defaults create an H.264 AAC MP4, which is suitable for most users, and that is true. Now, you can use a hardware encoder, and then you have these presets. Let's try H.264 high profile, or maybe does it give you presets like Premiere does with YouTube and all those formats? No, they don't. Okay, so I'm just going to... Oh, there it is, YouTube. Okay, so I'm gonna select this YouTube preset, which is H.264 AAC audio and an MP4 container for YouTube. So let's see how that goes.
It doesn't seem to ask me for any file. Probably it's going to ask me when I click export file down here, or if I click advanced, then I can probably, yes, I can configure the aspect ratio, the resolution here, the scan mode, and other things like interpolation. And you can change the quality, okay? You can change the quality, the codec, same thing for audio, and there's some sim flags here. I'm sure these flags and parameters are actually being passed to FFmpeg, so I'm not gonna bother changing these. Let's click export file. Okay, it wants me to specify where I want to save it, so I'm gonna go and select a folder. And I have clicked save. It seems I don't have a lot of disk space. That's not a problem. Yes, I want to continue. So there is a panel here that appeared called Jobs, which shows me the progress of my encoding. So there it is. It's exporting my file right now. It's quite fast, actually. Okay, so the export, I believe, is done. I have this check mark on the right side here that says it's done. So let's see the quality of the resulting video. Okay, so the file seems to be 11.9 megabytes. Not too bad. Let's open it up. So there it is. This is the file. Quality-wise, it doesn't seem too bad. Definitely, the title is big and red like I did it. Nothing seems to have shifted. And let's play it. That looks good. So the quality is good, considering the file that I used in the first place to feed it into it. And the file size is obviously not very large, so that is great. And, apart from little things, I haven't explored this, so I think I'm going to do a series on how to do things with Shotcut. This seems to be a very promising tool, and definitely for a free tool, it is far more advanced than I expected. And I think I've seen it mentioned a few times in various places, but I didn't really give it a second thought. So today I was looking for a way to reverse a video, so this one came up in the Google results. So there you go. I've decided to install it and do a first look for you. I hope you enjoyed this, and maybe it makes you consider using Shotcut. It is free after all, and for free, come on, it seems it is even slightly more advanced than DaVinci Resolve, at least the free version. The free version of DaVinci Resolve I used briefly, and it seems a little, limited in terms of what you can do with it, but this one seems a bit more advanced. And for a free tool, they have certainly added a lot of features in here, so I cannot wait to explore these. So thank you for watching. If you enjoyed my tutorials, please subscribe to my channel and stay tuned for more tutorials about Shotcut. If you have any questions or comments, let me know in the comments or requests, like feature requests for, you want to learn how something is done in any of these programs that I'm covering. Feel free to give me a comment and I will see if I can do it for you. So thanks again for your time. See you next time.